Hello, I'm Wayne from TorqueCars. We're going to have a chat now about stage two mods. Now, this is where tuning your car starts to get really interesting. So we're going to discuss 10 of the best mods you can do for your car. Look out for number 10, because that's a mod that can potentially double your power. So we've discussed stage one mods, those simple mods that don't require much expertise in fitting them on your car, and they don't require supporting mods in order to work. So now we're going to take things to stage two, where things start to get really interesting and you start to make significant power gains. Now, before we begin looking at the 10 best mods, it's worth saying that when you start adding mods together, you get more than the sum of their parts. So if you had a mod that gave you, say, 10 brake horsepower and another one that gave you 10 brake horsepower, by combining them, you might think you get 20 brake horsepower more. But in reality, you may well get 25 or 30 brake horsepower more, because they start to work together. So think of every mod you bolt on as adding a percentage of power to your car. So the more mods you add, the greater that percentage power gain is, and you get a much better headline power figure at the end. So in at number one, we're looking at sports camshafts and sporty cam profiles. So most manufacturers devise their cam to give you a reasonable economy, a decent bit of top-end power, and maintain the reliability of your car. So by altering the profile of your cam, which controls the intake valves and the exhaust valves and gives you much more control over the timing and the opening and closing of these, you can make significantly more power. Now, I should say that some cars already have fairly aggressive cams fitted. So if the manufacturer's already put a sports cam profile in there, the gains you get by adding a more aggressive profile is minimal, but still significant and worth considering in most cases. So just dropping a camshaft in requires quite a bit of specialist knowledge and expertise. If you get it wrong, you can actually accelerate the wear and tear on the cam itself, and the valves in the engine can stop working as effectively as they were originally intended. You can alter the lift, for example. If you're not getting the same amount of lift, you're not going to be making as much power as you otherwise would. So see our videos on camshafts for more in-depth information on those. But they really are a significant way of adding power. And if you've got a naturally aspirated engine, it's probably one of the best power gains you'll get for your money. So it's certainly worth looking at fast road cams, maybe getting your OEM cam profile ground to a faster road profile. So in stage one, we spoke about intake mods and exhaust mods. So stage two, you can assume that these mods have already been done, but we can start to look at the actual headers themselves, the bits that bolt onto the engine. And the way these flow and the bends in them, the angles, the way they machine can make a difference to the power that you get. So it's really worth getting high quality performance headers on the exhaust and on your intake, just to remove any restrictions that you might have in the intake and the flow rates going into your engine or out of the engine and the exhaust port. So we'll also mention the typical restrictions you get in the exhaust, the DPF filters, the particulate filters on diesels, the catalysts as well. It's a honeycomb that's designed to create reactions in the exhaust gases and remove the harmful gases that you don't want to be pushing out into the environment. So if these are restrictive, there'll be bottlenecks and sapping power. So you will usually get a performance benefit by adding a faster flowing alternative. Now, these are often bigger, the cell sizes are larger. They're still as effective as the OEM cap, but they don't restrict the flow through them as much. It's certainly worth paying attention to these potential bottlenecks in your system, especially when we come to stage two tuning, where we're going to be throwing a lot of extra mods into the car. And we really want to get the maximum benefit from all of those mods that we've done, and we don't want anything holding it back. So another stage two mod is thinking about the fueling. It's always a case that when you tune a car, you want to add more fuel and more air, and by combining those, your car will make more power. Now, people often forget about the fueling. They focus on mods that improve the airflow in and out of the engine. But without sufficient fuel, you may well hit an upper limit, and pushing through that is impossible unless you've upgraded the injectors. So getting higher capacity injectors usually requires a more beefy fuel pump to supply enough fuel to those injectors. It will remove the restriction in your fuel supply system. So I will say that just adding better injectors will not usually make more power unless your existing injectors have become clogged and ineffective. And rather than adding power, you're just restoring the lost power. But if you go to stage two tuning, you really do want to think about the whole engine and getting as much in there as you can to maximise your power gains. And fuel injectors and the fuel pump are significant areas that need to be focused on and addressed. It's usually recommended by most tuners that we speak to go 20% better on the flow rate. So rather than just working out what the flow rate needs to be and getting injectors that match that, you want that little bit of headroom and leeway so you've got some scope for additional tuning. And also, as they get older, they will degrade, and you really want the benefit of having that extra capacity, so as they start to wear, they're not as effective, so you start eating into that 20% of headroom that you've built in. But you won't get flat spots, you won't get breakdowns, you won't get issues if you do that. So always over specify the flow rate on your injectors. So we start thinking now about actually removing the head on the engine itself. The head is quite a busy network of junctions. It controls the air coming into the engine, the fuel unless you've got direct injection, and the exhaust as well goes through the engine's head. So just maximising the channels and flow rates, making sure there's no restrictions. If you really went to town, you'd probably try and straighten some of these port openings and entranceways into the engine to just maximise the ability of that head to flow the air in and out of the engine. But the valves and the area around the valves is important. The air goes between the valves when they're open into the engines, and by doing a 3 or 5 angle valve job on the valve seat, you can maximise that airflow and you get a better seal when the valve is actually closed. So we really do recommend you get this done professionally. It's not the sort of job you can just do with a grinding wheel yourself. It requires some specialist knowledge, and we've even seen some experts that have come along to tune a cylinder head, and they've really made a mess of it. They've used low quality tools. The cuts that they've made around the valves have left rough spots or chips, which really won't do anything to enhance the airflow. So it really does pay to get someone who knows what they're doing to work on the head of your car. And increasing the size of the valves is an option on most engines as well. So that's another way of getting more air into the engine and getting the exhaust gases flowing out of the engine. But again, you need to look at the engine as a whole. You don't necessarily just want to open up the valves. You need to do other mods in order to support that. But as we're in stage two, that's perfectly acceptable. We're looking at maximising your mods and really doing everything we can to get the maximum power from your engine. So another area that you need to address with stage two mods is your clutch. That's usually one of the first things to show up a problem, and it will start to slip. You're now making 20%, 40%, 50%, you might even have doubled your power. So expecting that standard factory clutch to cope is asking a bit much. It's just not designed to handle these levels of power and torque. So getting an uprated clutch is a significant benefit and certainly should be a part of every single stage two tuning project. There are quite a few considerations to buying a clutch. There's lots of options in clutch materials and clutch designs. You've got multi-plate clutches as well. So we discuss those in another article. We're just going to flag up the fact that we need to pay attention to the clutch and get a clutch that's appropriate to the power levels that we're now producing through the stage two tuning that we've done to the car so far. And while we're talking about the clutch, it makes sense to talk about the flywheel. So this big hunk of metal attaches to the clutch assembly, and it stores the rotational energy from the engine. So by lightening that, you get faster responses on your rev changes. You notice that a sports car or race car will rev very, very quickly. And a road car, you press the accelerator and it slowly raises up and then slowly dips down. And most of that is down to the flywheel and the weight of the flywheel. So in most cases, reducing the weight of the flywheel will enhance that rev change. It'll make it much faster. It's more suited to fast driving and track work. There are some engines that I really would not recommend going much lighter or converting a dual mass flywheel into a single mass flywheel. We've done a video covering flywheels in a bit more detail, so be sure to check out that video and get all the information you need so you can make the right decision for you, for your car, for your engine, and to match your expectations on what you're trying to get out of your Stage 2 car tuning project. Another mod we're going to mention are nitrous kits. Now, nitrous oxide is a gas, and as it burns, it releases oxygen. So as well as adding fuel, it's adding its own oxygen to the mix. And often you need to match your nitrous kit with an additional fuel injector, such as the oxygen generated by the burning process of having a nitrous kit. Bear in mind that your nitrous bottle only holds a finite amount of nitrous, so it's not really a mod that you can just use all of the time. It's reserved for those bursts that you need on the track in drag races. It's impressive to add 50 brake horsepower to your engine just by bolting on a mod, but it's a lot more complex than that. You've got different types of nitrous systems that you can include in your car. Whether it's a dry or a wet nitrous system, for example, can add to the complexity of installing it, but also result in more power when it's actually fitted to the car and set up properly. The refills can be quite expensive. And I also need to mention at this point that nitrous kits are not legal in all areas. For example, some countries restrict engines to burning one type of fuel at a time. So adding nitrous is technically another type of fuel, and it wouldn't be legal to use a nitrous kit on the road. And people often worry about carrying a big canister of explosive gas with them. Now, without going into the complexities of how safe it is to carry a nitrous bottle and the way manufacturers set up the bottles and everything, a lot of legislators have just banned people from adding nitrous kits to their cars. So check in your area if it's legal. If it's not a road legal mod, then it would be pushed into our Stage 3 categorisation for mods. So it's not something that you'd necessarily want to do in your Stage 2 tuning project. But it's interesting to just investigate. It's a nice way of adding substantial power to your car, but it's, as we said earlier, only suitable for giving you bursts of power for fairly short durations and at wide open throttle. It doesn't do much for your everyday drivability and improving the car on a daily basis. So now we come to the ninth mod, which was actually the best mod we recommended on Stage 1, and that's remapping. We're no longer just remapping a factory spec OEM engine. We're starting to add other mods. So when you remap your standard engine, you're basically just removing the wide margin of error the manufacturers build in and extracting the maximum performance you can from everything the manufacturer gives you. With Stage 2 tuning, you're improving a lot of other areas of the car, and it really means that that leeway the manufacturers built in, you can now exceed that. So if you've fitted stronger components to your engine, you've increased the fuel injectors. The map can take into account other mods like your fast road camshaft and a lighter flywheel. You can dramatically alter the way the engine works. And with Stage 2 mods, we've seen people making power gains of between 50% and 80% more power just from a stock block, but with other components added into the mix. And the map is a great way of pulling out the benefits of all the other mods that you've done. You can do so much with the timing, the spark advance, the fueling, and everything that your ECU controls. By tightening that up, it releases all of that power that you've built into your Stage 2 mods and Stage 2 project. It really is a no-brainer to get a Stage 2 map done on your car. Now, the 10th mod, the significant one that can potentially double the power of your car, are turbo upgrades. So if you've got a naturally aspirated engine, there's a lot of work involved in adding a turbo to it. But that work does pay off. You can literally double the power that you make. With a naturally aspirated engine though, you'll need to lower the compression ratio in most cases and fit stronger internal components. But when you think about it, you're adding so much more power. It just makes sense to do all of those things anyway. If you've already got a turbo engine, you've probably got stronger components in it. For example, a lot of manufacturers will use forged pistons, forged cranks, and bigger port sizes on the head. And the engine is set up for making more power, so you've got the scope there to just add a larger turbo. Now, adding a larger turbo will dramatically alter the profile of the power that you get. So you can actually specify whether you want all your power at the bottom end or top end boost. You can, with a big turbo, get significant power gains at the top end. Or you just want a little bit more flexibility across the entire RPM range. we've done other videos on turbos and we've got some more plans. So turbo mods are a great way of adding significant amounts of power to your engine. So be sure to subscribe to our channel if you've not done so already. We've got lots of in-depth videos coming up. This has been a very general guide to stage 2 tuning, but I'm working my way through all of the topics that we've been asked to cover. So don't forget to stay tuned and please like this video if you haven't done so already, because it really helps us to get out there. Thanks for watching.